And I can't say that it's because I'm getting old, because I always was like that. Always. I wanted to go to bed around 8:39. So now I'm back to Zachmaninoff. So we are mathematicians, but it was really nice to take that excursion and dig in and do this. I don't think that I've actually ever, I know that I've never plotted the solution, but I don't think I've ever taken it that far where I've seen the whole thing drawn out. So that was nice, but we're mathematicians. So we're going to go back to thinking about this theoretically. And this lecture was wonderful for me because I got to do two things. I got to actually dig in and draw one of these pictures and see the guitar string waving around. And I got really excited. But the other part that made me excited was maximum principles. If there was anything that I loved in PDEs was the maximum principles. I thought they were the coolest things in the world. So we're going to go to Laplace's equation. And I didn't have a chance to do this, but there is a book called The Maximum Principle. It's an entire book where they use the maximum principle to prove things about Laplace equation. So I'm going to give you some terminology that they talk about in Zachmaninoff. Solutions to Laplace's equations that are C2 are called harmonic functions. So in physics, they talk about harmonic functions quite a bit. And I was always confused, how did they do this without PDEs as a background course? Because the definition of a harmonic function is that it's a C2 solution of Laplace's equation. If we have time at the end of this class, you know, what we'll do is towards the end, I'm going to pick some special topic. And I'm going to have a party with that special topic. And I might lose you for a bit, but sometimes it's good to see something like you said, modular. Like you saw it early, and maybe you didn't fully understand it then, but then you see it again, you're like, wow, I see this all coming together. So it'll be one of those things where we just fly for a while. And towards the end of this class, I'm thinking maybe to do some of these weak solutions to equations. So there's a whole set of solutions that you can think of to this Laplace equation that are not C2, and they're not harmonic. So you might think right now, what would that beast look like? It's a strange way to look at these solutions. So you can think of the following. Like, if I restrict myself to C2 functions, I get some solutions. But if I expand that set and I allow L2 functions, then I'm going to get other solutions that are not C2 but are L2. So in the non-intersection of those two sets, there's going to be a set of solutions. And I can keep making the space bigger and bigger, and I'm going to get more solutions the bigger I make the space. So that's where you get these solutions that are not harmonic, that are solutions to this equation. Boundary values, so you heard the word Dirichlet, and it's also called the first boundary value problem. The formal definition of Dirichlet boundary is not that u of x is 0 on the boundary, but in fact that u of x is defined by a very particular function on the boundary. So that's the formal definition of Dirichlet boundary condition. And it's also called first boundary value problem. So for example, this is a Dirichlet boundary condition, because I'm forcing u of x to be c on the boundary of omega. And omega could be a set in Rn. So it could be, I'm thinking of things in n variables, as he does all the time. He's always showing you examples with 3 variables, not 2, something you can't really see anymore. Notice, by the way, that if I take u of identically equal to the constant, it's a solution, because if I take the second derivative of a constant, it's 0, so it satisfies the equation, and it satisfies the boundary condition. In fact, it turns out that for this particular problem, the constant solution is the only solution. And that's where maximum principles come in. They actually can prove that for you. The Neumann problem, or the second boundary value problem, is the one where you have a condition on the outward normal, the flux of u on the boundary. And just by definition, he uses in the book this symbol, partial of u with respect to n. What that means, it's called the directional derivative. And it's inside your calc book, actually, in calc 3. They talk about directional derivatives. And again, it's one of those things in calc 3 where you're reading through it going, another formula, took the test, done with that. So it, if you go back and look in your calc book, you'll see what it is again. They'll probably have pictures where they draw what that looks like. So it's also called the normal derivative, and the normal derivative is defined. So the flux is defined on the boundary, and this is called the Neumann boundary condition. A lot of times you see that set to zero, but it's not, zero is not the Neumann boundary condition, it's just set to a function. So where are we in the book right now? We're on page 191, and we're talking about mean value properties and the maximum principles for harmonic functions. So the mean value theorem from Calc 1 is, when you go into mathematics, it becomes one of your favorite theorems. I think if you walked around the department, it doesn't matter if they're in pure math or applied math, you ask them, what's your favorite theorem from Calc 1? Mean value theorem is going to make the top 10 list. It's just such a cool theorem. What it tells you is that in an interval, a function, the length of, or the area of that function, which in one dimension turns out just to be the length between the y values, is attained at a mean values, right? The mean value is going to be attained somewhere inside that interval. So it's pretty cool because as proof writing goes, you can work with the mean value a lot of times on a very short interval and get away with things. So this is the multidimensional mean value theorem. And there's so many multidimensional mean value theorems that are out there. This is one for multi-dimensions, and if you have a harmonic function, you have that the mean value is attained, and the mean value in this case is going to be given to you in the terms of an integral. I just wanted you to see the connection between the mean value theorem for integrals. This is the mean value theorem for integrals. You learn the mean value theorem for integrals in Calc 2, and you learn the mean value theorem in terms of derivatives in Calc 1. So what it's telling you is that the mean value here is equal to some point in the center times the length of the interval. So you see the connection between the two up there? This is u at x0 is really f at z. This thing right here is really this thing right here. So it's the same thing. It's multi-dimensions. And so I wrote it this way so you can see it. They're one and the same thing. It's pretty neat, right?
And I'm sure, I don't know how many of you took physics further than the required physics, but you use this a lot in physics.
There's a connection. It's the area of the line segment. So what we just looked at was a multidimensional version of mean value theorem. The maximum principle comes from the mean value theorem. It can be proved using the mean value theorem. So if I have a bounded domain in Rn, and I have that u is defined and continuous in the closed set on the boundary as well, and it's harmonic inside omega, so that means that u satisfies Laplace's equation, then it's going to attain its maximum and minimum values on the boundary. And you recall something like this in Calc 1 too. When you had to find maxes and mins on a closed interval, they either were attained somewhere at a critical point inside an interval or at the boundary, so something very close to that. Well, remember I told you that if you have that u is constant on the boundary and it's a solution to the equation, it's a harmonic function, then it has to be the only solution? Well, here it is. If the maximum and minimum values are attained on the boundary, and it's constant on the boundary, it's squeezed in between its max and min values, it is the constant. And that's the only solution you can possibly have. So there's another version of this maximum principle. And if I have d, I'm not using omegas here, I want you to see the picture. So now I'm looking at just a one-dimensional space. And if I have that, not that the Laplace equation is satisfied, but Laplace u is greater or equal to zero. So not even equality. So I'm working with the 1D Laplace so we can see the pictures. Then if u attains its maximum value, call it m, on any point on the boundary, then u is identically equal to m. So it's a different version of the maximum principle. And that book that I was telling you about called The Maximum Principle has tons of versions of the maximum principle, and you can use them to prove all kinds of beautiful things. So it's a bit stronger statement than the constant solution idea that I told you about earlier. So for the proof of this version of the maximum principle, you need a variation of the mean value theorem. And I'm going to save this just